So what I'd like to do is get the panelists to introduce themselves. Joe, we'll start with you.
Hi, Joseph Camilleri. I'm from Twitter. I run the vendor security program at Twitter, looking at all inbound requests for products and services that Twitter's looking to engage with. And I run an operational risk management function that does inherent residual risk ratings for our internal systems as well.
Nice. Nate Jones from Airbnb. I kind of self-describe my title as security grunt. Basically handle everything that isn't in a specific domain for somebody else. That includes third-party assessments, just because they cross a ton of things for us. So we're looking at legal, privacy, and security.
I'm Nathan McCauley from Docker. I'm usually the guy filling out the security questionnaires from all of our customers. I run security at Docker.
Hi, I'm George Totev. I'm the head of risk and compliance at Atlassian. So vendor risk management is part of the things that my team does. So it's very much in what we're doing.
Right. So vendor security has been something that's been a major, something that's been broken for a very, very, very long time. One of the things I want to do is, first of all, and I'll ask Nate over there. Nate, how is vendor security different than a proof of concept?
So in my experience, like proof of concepts tend to not be kind of the full thing you're going to end up using in production, right? So that's, they don't mimic exactly how you're gonna use things, the data you're gonna send, the stuff you expect back. And the environments can sometimes not be particularly close to what a production environment looks like. And so even if we evaluate those, we leave kind of this unknown level of risk out there because of the differences from a production environment. And that's probably the big thing, is just the environments aren't the same. And so we don't know how much the risk varies.
Anybody else on the panel want to jump in?
Yeah, I'll offer some thoughts. You're talking questions about POC, correct?
Yeah.
I often find that security is not involved in the POC, which is a frustration for me. Is and this isn't just in my current role, but at other organizations where the POC is all built out in the front offices, who are looking at the product and services and aren't thinking ahead at what security risk that product might introduce to the company, which gets them in a little bit of a mess at the end when they've went down to some vendor selection and start trying to engage us to do a security review. So one thing with POCs, I think, is really important is like getting the right appropriate parties in there to think about security risks ahead of the curve, rather than like when you're ready to buy and implement.
Well, we've got people from a number of different companies and different verticals. So George, I'll ask you a question. For vendor security, like this is not specific to Atlassian, but generally, have you seen different groups handle it? And if so, do they have different slants?
So actually, to continue on the conversation around the POCs, it is interesting because there is this distinction between when money changes hands and when there is no money changing hands. In other words, the fact that somebody is doing a POC doesn't mean that they're not looking at your data. So in our case, we actually have other distinguishing factors. It's not just whether we have a contract. Actually, if we don't have a contract with the vendor, that's even more dangerous. So I'm saying that because the focus is often after all the negotiations have happened, and there is a contract in place that the two legal departments start working on and start redlining. The actual work should happen way before that. So what I found to be more more successful is when we're, from the vendor security aspect, we're engaged earlier. When somebody starts thinking about engaging vendor, then we come in. And especially what we're talking about, the Vendor Security Alliance, do the preliminary assessment of the vendor, figure out what is going on, and that is factored in later on when the contract starts the negotiation. Because when we hit legal, probably already is too late. Most of the important things have been negotiated. There are certain expectations on our side and on the vendor side. So it is better to start these conversations around the security of the vendor earlier, as early as possible.
Okay, and back to one of the other questions I wanted to know is, when you look around the valley, is vendor security audits, are they done by the same group, or are you finding them in compliance, procurement, InfoSec, is it all over the place?
I would say that it's a little bit chaotic. between different companies, because it really depends on which part of the organization is more mature than the others, and usually that part of the organization gets involved first. That could be legal, that could be security, that could be compliance, and in general, it's a little bit inefficient that way, rather than having a streamlined process where we engage all of the stakeholders.
So quick question to the audience. Hands up of those who are a vendor who sells stuff. And keep your hands up if you get more than five completely different questionnaires that have no resemblance to each other every year. Yeah, that's pretty much what we're going after. So one of the questions on side on vendor security, what's the big value prop if you do it right? What does it stop from happening? And anyone on the panel, feel free to jump in.
Yeah, one of the things when a lot of questions I get after somebody who's been through a disastrous process of trying to select a vendor and has a very difficult time either getting pricing or security controls in place at that vendor is they start asking questions about pre-approved vendors. Like, who are the vendors we can use then? If not this, who? And that struggles me a lot because I don't have the ability to have insight into every other competing product out there unless we have an existing contract with them, if we've used them in the past, or I have industry contacts that can tell me more about the product or service. So the more upfront I can get with, if you're looking for a specific business efficiency tools, or if you're looking for some sort of hosting provider, the more I know about those and had a pre-approved list of those that have been vetted from a central repository, I'd have those types of lists that I could share as a starting point. Presently, I have a lot of blind spots in that space, and I come back with a big question mark of an answer. So that's one thing I think about would be very helpful is to have, quote unquote, vendors who've already been kind of through a process, have already measured their skills around security, data handling, et cetera, that I could come back to my clients and say, here's a great list to start with. Try to select your functionality around these products. We already are very comfortable with the security. It's going to speed up your time to delivery.
Yeah, I'll just kind of echo that. There's kind of a whole range of kind of maturity levels that companies have in this. I'm sure there are many security folks at companies around the Valley and all over the world who first find out about a vendor when they get an invite to collaborate on something. And they're like, hey, here, start using this new tool. And they're just like, oh, wow, I didn't even know we were using that. Super common. But one of the things that is really helpful if you're a security team is to maintain very positive rapport with the rest of the company. And one of the worst things you can do is tell somebody they can't use something that they've become emotionally attached to. And a lot of times when they do the POC, they start using it, it starts becoming part of the workflow. When you come in and say no, you actually, you hurt your effectiveness and you lose some of that capital that you need to be kind of keeping very, very close and using it so that when you actually need to say no, you can. So minimizing the number of times you have to waste capital by getting there earlier in the process can be super helpful.
And if you say no too often, people try to go around you, and that creates an entirely different security problem.
Yeah, and they manage to get around you. It just happens.
So. And especially nowadays with all the SaaS providers that are out there, going around the security is so easy. So it's better, to your point, to maintain this really good relation and have a list of almost like a pre-approved vendors that you're comfortable with. So when you see that, let's say, IT is going in a particular direction and they're going to engage a vendor to do X, you already have a list of 2-3 that you kind of trust and you say, you know what, why don't you start with those?
Yeah, that brings up again that question of scope, because a lot of the times when the proof of concept is going on, people are actually looking at the end product. But on the other hand, when vendor security risk people look at it, they're looking at, okay, using an end product, that's going to the cloud, where's the data going, who owns it, et cetera. So that's where a lot of the trouble has come. So about 6 months ago, well, maybe more, we've created and unleashed the VSA upon the world. So one of the things about it is it's actually a nonprofit, which is kind of different than a lot of the commercial organizations. Thoughts on that and why it should be that way?
I would say it's just about everybody has a vested interest in everybody doing better in this space. And so, we all have security teams to run anyway. And having it be a nonprofit helps us also eliminate kind of any idea that we're doing it for the wrong reasons. It's really doing it for the right reasons and to help the industry as a whole be more secure.
And we really wanted it to be for the benefits of the members. That is really important. So it's kind of an association of members that is non-for-profit. And That is the reason behind. And also there is the legal aspect of it. It's easier for our legal department to work that way. Otherwise, the VSA could be viewed as another vendor for us.
Exactly. And one of the things is that every year we update the questionnaire, and one of the people who sit on both the board and has been involved very much on the questionnaire is Joe. So Joe, what are your feedback on the questionnaire? Like, was it kind of grown very quickly, or was it a whole bunch of people and fought it out, or what happened?
Yeah, with regards to the questionnaire, I've been in an audit capacity role in my career. I've done a lot of risk management activities at large institutions who've spent a lot of money on measuring their own internal controls. And so I've seen a lot of shapes and sizes of products that we've gotten either from like consultants' help along the way or our own internal deliveries. And there's a lot of ways to ask the same question. And a lot of times, if you let something happen in a massive committee, you get hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different controls that you want to ask questions about. And it just it grows into, let me add 5 more questions on here just so I can capture some DR stuff. Or let me ask something else over here because I have a goal to understand where this data's at. And the questionnaire has become a fact-finding fishing expedition rather than targeted at really what you're after. And for this particular case, we're looking at security only. So we're not going to ask the other questions that might be on someone's mind, and we've been able to concentrate like our areas of like what are the things that when you're looking at a vendor product or service that get you to that level of quote unquote comfort? When do you get past that line where you're evaluating a vendor, you know the type of sensitivity of data you're going to give to them? What is it in that conversation through either interviews or audits or reviewing, you know, external reports that they've created that gets you past that line? So we tried to focus on getting the questionnaire to those things. And we had a very diverse group of people on the team who had specialties in very different subject areas as well that we allowed each other to kind of like use multiple questionnaires you've seen in the past, develop, put your own spin on it. And that collaboration, we spent about a little over a week or two in a room together and kind of, pushed out a questionnaire that represents the key areas that we were trying to measure vendors with, and now we have the confidence that there's not a blind spot in this assessment as far as we're concerned. We've prioritized things. We cut about 100 questions, I think, the first pass through. So there's a lot of effort that we, you know, the first list was massive. We dwindled that down to say, what are the priority things? And then we went as far as to kind of saying, let's measure those questions. What are the things that have the most weight when we're trying to evaluate a vendor so that when they are passed through an evaluation, we can come back with key areas of like, Is this something in a grading scale that I'm more comfortable, or is this going to expose the weaknesses in this vendor really quickly for me? So I think the questionnaire development process was similar to most companies that do in-house, but I'm very comfortable that it's covering the areas of security I'm focused on when evaluating a vendor.
Yeah, I was a little bit involved in the questionnaire development too, and one of the ways I kind of thought about it was a lot of times when I'm talking to someone responsible for security at a vendor, there are certain harbinger questions that I'll ask that I know represent that they're doing well in a bunch of different areas. So they're just certain key things that are kind of trailing indicators of an overall good security strategy. So we tried to put in some of those. The other thing we did was we wanted vendors to be able to put their best foot forward. If they're doing really good things, really innovative things in certain areas, we give them the opportunity to upload, you know, sort of documentation that kind of goes into some of those specific areas and really allows them to put their best foot forward, really show that they're kind of leading on security. So it's not just something that you need to think of as, hey, yes, I meet these requirements, but you can actually use it as a chance to kind of give yourself a competitive advantage, show how you're actually going above and beyond in certain areas.
Yeah, I think the other thing for me was just keeping it short. I don't know how many people here probably filled out really, really long questionnaires. You get tired. And frankly, like, there is a point at which you stop answering questions as, like, wonderfully and completely, as you probably should, and you only answer what you have to. And so we kind of wanted to stay out of that as well, right? Like, tell us more. Like, give us more information so that we can make a good decision. Rather than just check a box.
Yeah, and especially when that questionnaire has to be filled every year, so mm-hmm. We have to be cognizant. Yeah.
And with regard to the charitable side of it, where the questionnaire is released for free for everybody to use, we found that it's very useful when we have products that are being pitched and we start talking loosely about the size of the organization, how mature they are in their areas of security, and just other aspects of what they can deliver as far as SLAs to the business process that's using it. is they are these usually, there's a lot of 4 or 5 person companies who've spun up AWS instances really quickly and are trying to develop a really cool technology, but don't have a ton of like time to have thought about all the compliance things they'll need to do to sell to companies who are gonna evaluate that stuff. So the questions they you know, it's always day one, the CISO, the CEO, the CTO, everybody with a C-level who sits at the same, you know, around the table is ready to meet with you and tell you everything from, you know, how they encrypt things, where they encrypt things, and I'm like, I'm not really interested so much in all those detailed questions. What I want you to do is be able to kind of like start thinking about these and demonstrating that you do these types of controls. So the questionnaire has been something we've passed along to some of these folks where we just immediately know they're in a too immature of a state to do business with, but we can give them something like, here's a marker. Start looking at these types of things. Start developing operational processes around these things. And if you can start demonstrating these, we can get a lot more comfortable with doing business with you. But they kind of are starting with kind of like security or compliance types of activities. We're not things on their like roadmap to, you know, selling their first deal, selling their 10th deal. So it gives them a little bit of like a, here's what we're gonna measure you against when we start asking to do business with you, rather than just saying kind of like, here would be the contract terms I would wanna put as far as how you're gonna handle my data. Here's the underlying things that I'm gonna measure you against. So I found that some of the very small companies who are new have been very interested in looking at, like, thank you for this, this has been very useful. Now I can kind of start thinking about this and try to hit some of these targets in a prioritized way, so that when I come into my next vendor sale, I'm gonna have demonstrated evidence that I can deliver these types of things to handle your data.
And Joe, that's a very, very important distinction, because we should not look at the questionnaire as another compliance standard, because the goal of the questionnaire is really to measure the risk, not to tell you have to do 27,000 or something like that. So it's really what is the risk to us, and then when we receive the assessment from the VSA, then we can determine, okay, is that a risk that we can accept, or we need something more. So it's really a risk assessment questionnaire, it's not a compliance questionnaire.
Yeah, and before we actually start get into questions, I want to explain to everyone how the VSA, like what actually is the value proposition of it. So first of all, it's a nonprofit, so any company can join, that's number one, and then you get the chance to participate in the working groups and actually set the questions. But it has a number of values. The first one is that some of the problems we've heard were, some will come up to you on the last day of the quarter and say, we've done this proof of concept, go approve this. You're the bad guy, you come in and say, no, we need to look at it and ask all these questions. Suddenly they missed your window, or sometimes it even takes 2-3 months because you may have 30, 40 products you need to review, but 2 people. And every time you look at it, it costs $6,000 or $10,000 to put those people on, there's massive, massive delay. So generally we found it was broken everywhere. So the first thing we all decided to focus on is this questionnaire. Let's start asking the same questions. That's a hard thing to do because we're all different companies in different verticals. So we came up with a simple thing, let's measure risk. So the simple question we start off with is, what do you do? What data do you actually touch? So if you're an email, it's down here. You're dealing with something very, very, very sensitive, your bar is up here. And your goal is to show that your controls are actually reasonable compared to the type of data you're touching. Now that questionnaire, we released it at the end of September. It has been downloaded over 8,000 times. And some of our own members have been threatened with it already, so it's doing the rounds quite well. And for a number of companies, they just threw away what they were using, and they have this free open source one that's updated every year, and that's great. But some of the members wanted more. So this is the sort of things that we haven't announced, really. And what's actually happening is, when you get that list of 30 companies that you need to look at, you can now contact the VSA, and the VSA will put you in contact with external third-party auditors who will audit those companies. And instead of it costing you sort of like, you know, $10,000 to look at it, it's costing you less than two. So we're getting you really good auditors who do nothing all day but audit, and they're delivering these reports. And then the other thing is we share those reports. So for example, when somebody comes to you and says, hey, I'm doing a POC, I've got 10 companies, and you suddenly go on the VSA site and you go, wow, 6 of them, somebody in the group has already audited them. You can pull down those reports and you can say, those 3 look good to go. These other 3 are absolutely dreadful. No matter how good the product is, you're done. It's not happening. And the other 4 will kick off our audits. So that's kind of an overview of where we're going with it. And as well as that too, another problem it solves is, like, nobody joined a company on day one. The company was already there. It had important vendors who were touching our sensitive data. We always say it would be great to go back and look at them, but we never get a chance to. This is actually a chance to assign people to do that. So with that in mind, the mics are open. Happy to take questions or Go for it.
Hi, I'm Dave O'Connor. I work at Iron Mountain. So we probably receive as many questionnaires in a year as everybody in this room. We're assessed by customers in every single industry. Everyone has their own questionnaire. We're also a big participant in shared assessments. I'm on the SIG committee. So I think what you're doing is great, but you are adding yet another series of questions that we're going to have to answer in addition to the ones from the SIG, the ones that come built into Archer, the ones that come built into Hyperion, and all these others. So I think a big thing is going to be gaining acceptance of those questions as being comprehensive, because even with the SIG with 1,300 questions, we still get companies that are pulling questions out of the SIG and then adding their own. And then the only other thing I want to mention was it's great that you're aligning this to have auditors come in, but if you're not using an industry accepted auditing standard, nobody's going to accept it. At least not our customers. We have enough trouble getting them to accept AICPA audits. So,
yeah, that's not kind of what we found. So we actually did not want to come out. I mean, as you well know, there's a full SIG, and then there's a SIG Lite, and we find there's a lot of SIG Lite out there, and it's changed for things like privacy. We're like focused primarily on what's the risk and on the data, and that's really it. So it's not a, this is not a SOC 2. It's not a PCI certification. This is a litmus test of, should I be trusting these guys or should these guys not pass go? And because of that, and because it's open for companies to join and focus on key questions, like, we're finding a lot of acceptance for it. But you're right, it's early days. And when you start looking at certain sectors, especially regulated sectors, that will take time. Anybody from the panel want to comment?
Is with regulated industries, and everybody wants to have their own questions worded how they want, and it takes a lot of work to straighten that all out in the SIG committee. But I think it's great that you're focusing on risk, because that's not very common in most of the questionnaires we do. So,
yeah, you mentioned regulated industry. For them, the question is more towards compliance. So are you doing things in a certain way? And as we are all mentioning, our questionnaire is more to measure the risk. You can do it pretty much any way you want it, so long as the risk is at the level where I can accept it. So the regulated companies will continue to use their standards. Yep. We're not trying to get into that space.
Oh yeah, one thing is worth mentioning as well is scope. Sometimes you're looking at certain things, like our scope is the service you buy. For example, it's worthless for us to audit Microsoft when you're only buying Office 365 or Azure. So that's kind of another thing. We just want to know, because we've all been CISOs, and we know that we have these pretty beautiful policies, and then the DevOps guys do something completely insane. Yep. We're looking on what are they doing. And unlike certain scanning products, we actually deeply engage with the vendors. That's kind of a differentiator as well.
Cool.
Thank you.
And something else to mention, actually, which is very important. From the beginning, we're focusing on the service that we're buying from the vendor, not on the vendor. And those are two different things.
Hey guys, my name's Sam. I'm probably gonna piss off the Iron Mountain guy with this question, but I'm curious about what the process is to get more questions added, or maybe tweaked. I represent a software vendor. We make privilege access software. I'll try not to sound like a commercial, but we're a niche of the identity access market, and our core reason for existence is to provide secure access tools for vendors. So I see in the questionnaire you've got some great questions about, are you using multi-factor? Do you have password complexity rules? Do you allow VPN access to hit production servers? But it seems like you've got some opportunity to call out more specific requirements in the same way that I would say calling out multi-factor is very specific for authentication, but maybe you've missed, like in the password complexity question, for an example, the idea about rotating passwords very frequently to prevent attacks like pass the hash and things of that nature. My short question is, how do I get in and try to manipulate you guys to add some better questions?
Easiest answer is join the VSA.
Okay.
We have a working group that is where our kind of charter is to update the question set every year, so that we're taking things out that don't make sense, adding things that do make sense, and over time actually looking to improve security. We would like to start at a certain level and over time raise security of the entire industry by making the questionnaire more robust.
Okay.
Now that said, you should expect a healthy debate about any particular thing, and there's many opinions on all different types of things.
So. Is there beer involved in the working group?
When it's all over, yes.
Okay.
Everything's possible.
We'll be there then. Okay, thanks for the question.
Thank you. Oh, and just on the password complexity, just as an FYI, some of the inside stuff, we put that in there, so that's a minimum bar. And I mean, we're total multi-factor rotating. You know, that's kind of our focus. But if your bar is, you're not even hitting that one, it's a bad sign. I think you call them harbinger questions of doom is approaching if you're answering these ones badly.
So I'm on both sides of audit. I receive questionnaires from vendors who are evaluating my company, and I also send them. And I find that a lot of the questions just don't apply. So I would love a dynamic questionnaire where the person who is asking for the product first answers some simple questions about how they're using it. And then based on that, the questions would appear that are actually relevant to how they're using it and the data that they're
it's
using.
It's already in development. So basically, when on the first page, we ask you what type of software, what type of product you have. And you might say, well, I'm SaaS only, or I'm like on-site only. And literally, the logic is going to make all those things appear, not on the Excel spreadsheet, but we're actually working, and we'll have an online form very, very soon where that will exactly happen.
So an online form. So then we would send a link? Is that
so what would happen is you would be, say, for example, if you're being audited by one of the VSA members, you'd get an email saying, hey, you've been selected for audit because you're with Twitter. And VSA will be carrying out the audit. You'll get a link. You'll go to the website. You'll log on with very basic multi-factor if you're a vendor. And then you will fill in a form. And on that form, we'll say what type of software, what type of product do you have? And then based on that, the following questions will change.
OK. All right, I want to see that.
Okay. Thank you.
Greg Kahn, sorry. I've been doing third-party vendor risk for about 5 years now. I worked for a large financial firm based out of San Francisco here. And we would actually go to Iron Mount, follow them around. We would do site reviews. We had questionnaires. We didn't want to become involved in the SIG because we weren't crazy about it. Because when you go on site reviews, and this, the question's about auditing, what are you guys going to give us back based on not just what the questionnaires are, but what your auditors might see? Because we would see .10s in their firewall rules because it's going back to their house. That's their out-of-band management. We would see data center doors propped open, cart doors unlocked because they got tired of using the turnstiles. So are you going to supply audit findings back, or the, you know, has a negative connotation, but really all they are just action items that you've seen at a point in time, right? And they need to fix that. Are you going to supply that back, or do you see that coming back to you guys?
Yeah, we carry out the audits. Again, we're trying to balance on, we're really looking at data security practices. So if you're somebody who's got, you don't have a data classification matrix and you're just gluing crap on, like you're gonna fail and fail really, really hard. We're really focused on, like, do you think about security multiple levels of your organization? No, you can always supplement what you have, and this is gonna be on the platform. Like, hey, I've also got a SOC 2, hey, I've got a PCI, hey, I've got these things. But the core focus is gonna be, are you handling the data right, and how likely are you to be the source for our next breach?
So, but are your auditors doing point in time inspections of the vendors?
There will be ongoing audits, so it'll be possible to get like reassessed yearly, so that you can show improvement.
But am I going to see a this vendor didn't have this in place?
Yes,
am I going to see that?
You'll see that in detail. What it is not a physical on-site inspection, because quite honestly, most of the things we're looking at now are in Amazon or Heroku or somewhere
right.
What we're really saying. And that's actually one of the big impacts. Like, some of the companies, like, are the Y Combinator groups, for example. They keep on, you know, coming up, and I'm a YC graduate, saying, what types of things should we be building? Now they're just taking in that questionnaire and going, okay, great, know what to do now.
Okay, thank you.
Hi. No, it's working, sorry. So I work with a big box retailer, and I'm still not quite sure how your questionnaire or what you're trying to provide would be different than the SIG.
Yeah, so there's a couple of things. So the SIG, right, you know, it changes and it focuses on certain areas. And if you look at the SIG Lite right now, it's just massive chunk on privacy and certain areas that may not be necessarily directly relevant to you. So we're trying to make it more relevant to how you're handling data and data classification. That's one. But even when you have the SIG, we'll say, for example, if you know there's an awesome company X that's sitting up here and we're very interested in it, right now you'd have one audit from me, one. Now you've got five bit SIGs. Now, technically you could say, yeah, but if it's a big SIG and they're asking all the same questions and not changing it, I can just supply the same answers to all five of you. Correct, but we still have five separate audits. So one of the things we're also bringing in is that next level of bringing a third-party auditor, like, boom, that person's been audited, and now all five of us can get their results in real time. So that's kind of, it's a multiple level thing, because even if you have all agreed on the same questionnaire, you're still gonna come across that scalability issue. And the whole point is quite often in vendor risk management, you don't have the luxury of a, you know, 2-3 weeks or 4 weeks to an audit, or even kicking it further down the road. You've gotta make a snap decision, no. And that's really what we're trying to do is turn vendor risk assessment into actually a real-time decision-making, which actually really benefits the company.
Hi, like her, I'm on the both sides of the boat. So we answer close to 3,000 requests a year and ask not as many, but you know, in hundreds. So I'd like to understand, and I have two questions, you know, I'll follow up with you after the first question. How do you measure a particular vendor, right? You know, your specific service, you measure a particular client. Mm-hmm. Say for example, IBM has a whole suite of services. We ourselves consume multiple services with them, so I have to do multiple engagements with them. There is an API connection coming, they can be a co-host for us, and you know they come in many capacities. So let's say Twitter has done in their own capacity for their own service, how can I use that report, right? Yep. I don't think it is relevant for me.
Yeah, I mean, for most companies out there, even like we'll pick on Atlassian, like they have multiple different services. So we'd go off and we'd go hit that service. When it starts becoming very customized and productized, then you know there's always kind of an issue. So I think even if we end up hitting 95% of what's out there, I think we'll be happy. But primarily, we're looking at that service. What data does it touch? Where is that data stored? How is it accessed? Who has access to it? We're asking a lot of those real core fundamentals. That's what we're really going after.
Okay, so. We are doing very similar to what you guys are doing. You call it Vendor Security Alliance, we call it Cyber GRX. So what we are doing is, you know, right now, I come from ADP, so we subject ourselves to an audit that covers a suite of services that we offer.
Of course, yes.
And then that comes every quarter, like four times a year, not a annual thing because 12 months is a long time. And then also in addition to that, we have an outside-in look, which is continuous. You know, you see the cloud security brokers, right? So that's a continuous look into a particular vendor. That way you get, anytime you want to do business, you have a snapshot of how their outside in look is and then a quarterly report of how they're doing. Any thoughts on how,
There's about
increasing frequency?
Yeah, there's about, there's a couple of things there. Number one, there's about five different scanning vendors we've talked to, and they add some great value. The question, of course, always is context, such as I found this really bad development server in AWS that nobody really uses, but it looks really, really bad. So, but you know, what we want to do is we're a nonprofit. We're focused on doing one thing really, really well, and that's setting that kind of bar for everybody. And we'll happily partner with everybody in those other areas to give that context. The other thing is that if you've been audited, say, in January and you didn't do so well, and now it's March and you've added in four new security controls, you can trigger a re-audit. But you know, anytime, just like PCI, anytime there's a significant network change or change of risk, you should be re-audited, and you can trigger that yourself, or one of the members can trigger it for you.
Thank you.
Actually, I'll go to the back.
Okay, I'll be quick. Miles Sewer, I run something or facilitate something called the CIO chat. We have CIOs from around the world. If you're interested, I would invite you to come and join us on a Thursday for the chat so you can talk to them about what they'd like to see in terms of the process so you can help standardize it. So that's my invite.
Happily.
Thanks. Quick question around, I know there is a Google open source vendor assessment framework, right?
Yes.
Is there any difference between that and your framework? But did you compared the
framework? I mean Google's gone off and they've done a really good thing. And that's that, you know, just like, you know, there's a lot of questionnaires that you know, you have to pay for. And even then, you know, a certain percentage of people pay for that amount of money every year. But then there's a lot, like there's 90% of all the companies that are just using random stuff. Mm-hmm. And you know, Google said, okay, well, at least we're going to open source something. That's really good. We've done something similar, except we're generally a very high growth industry with a lot of online, a lot of stuff in the cloud. And that, obviously, Google loves that too. But we're getting it run by the members. You know, we're looking at what breaches are happening out there, what security whoops have happened in the last 6 months. We either change the questions or we change the weighting of the questions. Anybody want to comment on that? All right, that was it.
All right.
Thank you.
Yes, two related questions, both having to do with open source software. So in the first scenario, you know, I'm a vendor, say, building some product or service, and my developers come to me and say, we want to use this piece of open source software. Is there anything in what you're doing that allows me to treat where the open source comes from as like a vendor which can be evaluated using your stuff? And then related question is basically one level up. Now I've built my product or service and it uses some open source. In fact, it may use 1,000 different pieces of open source, and you're evaluating me. Is there anything in your questionnaire that digs into what we're doing with open source and et cetera, et cetera?
Yeah, we're asking generally whenever you're building software, like what's in your libraries, where are you getting your code from? So that's one thing, and a lot of companies, quite honestly, can't even produce a list. So that's kind of a start producing a list. Then we also start looking at what are your, and this is a big section for us, the secure software development lifecycle. How are you building? How are you testing? How are you integrating? Are you even doing that? Because a lot of companies aren't. They're just throwing code up as fast as possible. So we're looking at how are you building it? How are you testing it? So at least if you know what's in there, that's a start. But also if you've got comprehensive security tests, which you catch the heartbleeds, et cetera, of the world, you're a lot better than certain vendors that when that happened had no idea, you know, that they were using OpenSSL. Yeah.
So we've got our list. We know what we're using to build. Do you have like a whitelist or a blacklist?
We're agnostic. We're making sure that you're testing it and what your practices and procedures are. We ask you a lot of how often do you test it? If there's an incident, how do you push things out? Have you really thought through the process and are you actually doing them?
Okay.
I kept this use case in mind when working on the questionnaire. So I'm from Docker. We have hundreds of committers every month that are outside of the company that I work for. And so like figuring out how to do the secure software development lifecycle when there's just a multitude of contributors is something that took particular care to think about there. And in, generally speaking, folks that are caring about something like Vendor Security Alliance are probably going to be wanting to get support from some vendor for their open source software. So in a lot of cases, I would imagine that the VSA questionnaire would be targeted at the vendor you're asking for support from your open source software.
I'll go to the back.
Let's say I assess a vendor, and let's say A, B, C, F, and I give them a C, and they feel they're a B. Do they have the right to challenge that before it's published? And then also, let's say you have a score of a D. Is that just published to everyone? What's the access? And
Great question. So there's a couple of different types of reports that will come out. Some of them will be public. Say, for example, when we have looked at, we'll just make up like cloud DLP vendors, right? When we've looked at like 7 or 8 of them, or pretty much most of them, we'll publish out a chart and say, hey, there's 6 of them, and some of them are awesome, some of them are whoa. But we're probably not going to name names at that point, but then internal VSA members will be able to get their hands on that. And it's always asked the great question of, my vendor sucks, I think they do, but how do the others compare? And that will kind of answer it. It's kind of like a, you know, couldn't use the magic quadrant word because we would never do such a thing, but it's that kind of a concept of who in this area is actually really good at security practices. But that's kind of where we're focused. And the other question is, can you challenge it? Yes, you can, based on evidence. You definitely can earlier on before we publish. And then the other thing is, for new vendors who are terrified about the after effects of this, we're giving some vendors up to 3 months to fix their stuff before we publish it. So if it's something we found that's fundamentally wrong, and they commit to fix it within 3 months, we can re-audit them then. If they haven't fixed it in 3 months, we go with the original score.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. In the front?
Yes. I love the idea, love the direction. Briefly checked out the set of questions, and having been on kind of both sides of the fence, this is certainly a pain point for just about everybody. So great stuff. The question I had, having gone through and actually created a lot of these myself, one of the things that I did see, or that we had done that I didn't see in yours, was kind of the history of breach and what the kind of security history of the company had been. Is that an intentional thing? Do you not think that's a factor? Is that something that you have kind of coming? And any thoughts on that one way or the other?
Anybody want to hit it? I mean, my kind of worry is so many companies rebrand, rechange their architecture, move to the cloud. I mean, quite often you're looking at different things all the time. And I think for a number of those companies, you know, they will actually, if they had a major breach, they will go re-architect, rebuild, restructure, and actually get it right. Definitely. So we're judging them on how they are on that day. Because we've been involved with a number of companies that have had whoopses in the past, and they fixed it.
Yeah, I think it's actually really good feedback for us. And it's like Ken was saying, it's one of those opportunities that sometimes you learn from that, and you come out of the other side of that better than you were before. So it might make sense for us to add something there. So I would again pitch that maybe you would want to join the working group and help us out in this area.
I was going to say that was actually exactly where I was going with that. One of the things that we had found to be very useful was companies that had actually had small issues in the past and really kind of motivated management to start reinvesting in that space. So that's right on the mark.
Perfect. Yeah. I've often asked that as part of due diligence for acquisitions.
Interesting.
Perfect. Yeah, and that's one of the things about the working group is we don't all agree, but we all hash it out. And this is why it's much better than like one company where I'm setting the direction. And that's why we'd love to have you on board.
Perfect. Appreciate it. Thank you.
I think we're running out of time, so we'll have one question at the back. And then anything else, because we have somebody starting 5 minutes after us, we'll take them outside.
Yeah, I was curious how the VSA group looks at audit reports. So for example, if you were to pose a questionnaire to me and I said, well, a lot of your questionnaire is addressed by this, well, theoretically, we'll say SOC 2 or ISO or whatever, right? Or there are some companies now that are even going to say, look, I have so many audit reports, I'm not going to go through this process. If you want to get the information, you're welcome to go look at my page that we've set up or whatever. I'm curious, how do you as VSA members look at a response like that when you're looking at this kind of assessment evaluation?
Yeah, when you start looking at SOC, I mean, there's, you know, the different heads of SOC, and a SOC report is very different than somebody else's SOC report. I mean, it's kind of like writing poetry, right? You've got so many wheels and widgets you can tweak, it's kind of questionable. Now, the other thing is that we're going for something that, again, it's going to cost $2,000 as opposed to SOC 2, which is $100,000. So we're really looking for that good quality litmus test. And quite often, the SOC 2 may not go into the details of who's accessing the data, where is it, what are actual controls. Because a lot of times they're done by auditors, not by security people. That's why the auditors we pick are actually security people who've done both internal and external audits. So that's kind of the real data. We're worried about a real data breach, not do I look pretty and how's my uptime.
So I would assume then that by what you're saying, the response would be kind of a, yeah, great, thanks, but we still want to do...
Exactly. It's kind of like, if you'd like to do business with us, here it is. It's really nice and simple.
Got it. Understood. Right. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. I'd like to thank the panel.
Thanks.